it's a big advantage to know the culture of your city on all these fundamental levels that don't even really register until you go to another town and go, well, that's not the way it is in my town. And they go, well, so what?
Hey guys and gals, Trevor here with another episode of the Carrot Cast. And I've got a really special guest on today. And Mitch is both a client of ours, but also he has quite an amazing background. And not every day you get to talk to someone who's been a part of buying, you know, over 1,000 houses. He's written some amazing books. And we just want to bring Mitch on here to talk about life in general, his story, kind of what got him there, but also there's some things that he's doing right to be able to build a really strong real estate investment business through recessions, through good times, through bad. And we're going to talk about those, talk about how he funds his deals, you know, how is he selling his deals, and how do you remove the banks so the banks aren't kind of that liability, you know, they're stopping you from buying or selling houses. So we're going to talk about a lot of stuff, including those. But Mitch, welcome on the call, man.
Man, Trevor, I'm happy to be here. Thanks. Appreciate you.
Man, I'm glad you're here, and I appreciate the heck out of you too, man. It's been cool seeing, you know, I don't know when we originally connected, whether it was 6 months ago or a year ago or around there, but I started to really dig in and see all the things that you have done in real estate and life in general, and just really admire what you've been able to accomplish, man. So thanks for coming on the call.
Well, it was a work in progress and still is, and I don't think it'll ever end. So I don't know. It just keeps going.
Yeah.
Some things get easier and some things get tougher, but for the most part, they get easier.
Mm-hmm. I love it. So here, just so we can give a little bit of framework for people listening to this podcast, where do you call home? What's your business life look like right now? What's your family life look like right now?
Okay. I live in San Antonio, Texas, is the area that everyone would know, but mm-hmm. I really live in Canyon Lake, which is about 40 minutes north in the hill country. I've been building my house for 27 years. I'm almost finished. I built it out of my pocket, started a long time ago, lived in it when it was just a concrete slab and some, I could see every 2x4 inside the house. Mm-hmm. Didn't think a woman would ever want to hang out with a guy sleeping on a concrete floor looking at 2x4s, but found somebody. Been married 27 years now. She never left.
Excellent.
Although I've tried my best to run her off. little humor there. Yeah. And then I inherited her 13-year-old daughter, and she's become my daughter, or our daughter, and she's been working for me for 20 years. She closes every deal in and every deal out for 20 years.
Oh, wow.
She also had collected all my payments and everything for 20 years, which was thousands of payments. And so she recently opened a note servicing company called Moat Note Servicing, MOAT, as in the moat around a castle.
Yeah.
MoatNoteServicing.com. And she does a great job there. We're having fun growing that little business. That's like the newest startup, but that's hers. And I'm letting her, I'm so happy she wants to be an entrepreneur after 20 years because I've given up on her. and then so my business is, I've always, for 20 years, since 1996, I have been in love with the buy it, fix it, or don't fix it, owner finance it for a tremendous margin, like usually around double, and then collect a down payment, collect payments. So buy it, fix it, or don't fix it, and owner finance the sale. Mm-hmm. And but along the way of doing that, I become really good at all the different aspects or strategies, because every lead that you get, you want to make sure that you capitalize on, because you're spending money to get these leads. And so if you get a subject two, you learn how to do a subject two. If you get you know, an apartment complex, but that's not your gig, you either partner with someone that is, or you sell it to someone that knows what they're doing. So, you know, we learn to capitalize on every lead. I do my fair share of wholesales, because not every house is perfect for owner financing. So wholesales, to take a page out of Jack Bosch's book, you know, you got your one-time cash, and then you got your owner finance, which is temporary cash because these notes are going to expire. And then for my forever cash, I bought boat storages and mini storages, and I have about 1,100 doors in 14 locations around the lake where I live, boat and mini storages.
Sweet.
So that's most of my businesses. We don't need to go into the other ones, but they're just all real estate related offshoots. But
no,
that's my primary core.
I love it. And just like you mentioned, you kind of mentioned Jack Bosch's book, and I want to bring this up really quick, because Man, that book is a great book, by the way. So it's
It is
called
a great book.
Forever Cash. You guys can find it. I'm sure you can find it on Amazon. Great book, guys and gals. If you want to really, really learn how to think about not just real estate, but your life in general from the financial perspective, how to structure that correctly, because most people don't structure it correctly. You know, we're working our butts off on active income, kind of that everyday income. But most people don't get to the forever cash side of it. So get the book, and we're going to talk about, Mitch has written many books. Well, I'm sure we'll talk about some of your books here as we go, because we only have like an hour here. So people are going to, as we bring up topics, I'm sure that there's some places that we can send them to really get the rest of the story and the rest of the meat as we go. So a couple quick questions for you on the business, and I want to kind of dive in and unpack some of that owner finance stuff in a big way, because that's something that we have been hearing about more and more from our clients. You know, we have owner finance sites that we've been kind of behind the scenes setting up for some clients. We don't officially have them out there. I think you were probably one of the first ones that has something like that up there. And
yeah, I'm a big supporter of OnCarrot. I'm a believer. I have OnCarrot sites myself, and a lot of those people that you're getting that are in the owner finance are coming from me, because I'm telling them you got to go over here, because I know what the sites did for me. So it's real easy to recommend, you know.
Awesome.
Real easy.
I love it, man. I love it. So on your business, are you strictly in Texas, or you invest outside of Texas?
I don't invest in my hometown. I'm like probably about 1,500 houses since 1996, almost exclusively in my hometown or within an hour from here, you know, in the surrounding areas, you know.
Cool.
But mostly in my hometown.
Dude, so on that right there, on that topic, you know, there's a lot of markets right now that are kind of getting overheated and getting really competitive, and people are going into other markets. You know, we've got a client we had on a podcast, Martin Bonesire out of Phoenix, and he does 10 to 20 deals a month. And that market was getting pretty competitive. So then he stretched out into Grand Rapids, which he's picking up another 10 plus houses a month over there. What kind of over your years, man, 20 years, you've been through some cycles. You've been through some ups and downs.
Absolutely.
Why did you make that decision yourself to stay not just in Texas, but in that geographical area that's around your home, and not branch out?
Well, the first reason is I deal largely in private money, and I am solely responsible for that money, and I take it very personal. Mm-hmm. And to have money spread out all over the country, if there was some kind of recession or something and I needed to defend my private lenders, you know, I didn't want to be spread out everywhere, mostly so that I could do them. I stayed in my hometown so that I only had one place to be to focus if there was a debacle. Mm-hmm. You know.
Yep.
And I'm a bit of a doomsdayer sometimes, so I think of worst case scenarios, maybe a step past where everyone else thinks the worst case is.
Yeah.
And so that thought process might have limited me some, or it might be a great decision. You'll never know until a debacle hits, you know?
Yeah. So are your private, and we'll dive into private money here, I'm sure, on this call quite a bit, but a question that pops up. So are your private lenders mainly in that local area as well?
No, the private lenders can come from wherever.
Okay.
I mean, they're mostly from Texas. And a lot of them are from San Antonio, because that's where I hobnob and meet people and greet people, and that's just where I bump into people.
Mm-hmm.
But my private money can come in from as far away as New Jersey or Florida. It's not so much where the money comes from. It's where is everyone's money is concentrated. So I have a team that can take care of it. Right, Johnny on the spot every
yeah.
minute. You know, if there's something going wrong with that loan or that house, I'm right there.
I love that. So I want people who are listening to this or watching the video version, I want you guys to not gloss over this last couple minutes here, because you probably didn't start listening to this episode for that lesson. You're probably coming on for the owner finance, for the private money, just learning how this guy's bought, you know, over 1,500 houses, which we're going to get there. But this lesson is huge, because to me, that's a fundamental thing about your business that's helped make it successful. You said, I'm going to really own and understand this market so well that I protect the asset, I protect our investors, and also just you're building the business you want to build. You're not just taking any old opportunity you can find anywhere and spreading out your chips all over the place. Let me say this too, though. Yeah.
When you start going into other markets, like I bought 30 houses in Corpus. I mean, mm-hmm. there's a reason why I don't go out into these other places. I bought 30 houses in Corpus, and then I estimated a roof to be X amount of dollars. Well, then I learned about wind straps and hurricanes. I mean, we don't have that here, and made bad decisions. You know, it was an extra $6,000 for a roof that I didn't know. Yep. And then there's the city council's different, and the sign police are more aggressive or less aggressive. And to learn the culture of a town, there's 1,000 different pieces that you don't really realize that you're assimilating as you're working months after months after years after years. Mm-hmm. It's a big advantage to know the culture of your city on all these fundamental levels that don't even really register until you go to another town and go, well, that's not the way it is in my town. And they go, well, so what?
it's kind of the whole, you know, going deep versus going wide concept in business or anything you do, where you can either go really wide and get a little piece of a lot of stuff and really not be a full expert in any of it, but you're kind of a jack of all trades and everything, or you can go really deep, like you're going in your market and like, hey, I'm going to be the expert in the market. I'm going to know everything that I need to know about the market so I can act on stuff quickly, so I can run a great business. And going deep versus going wide is a big deal, which you guys are, you know, living proof of that in your market right there, which is cool.
Well, yeah, and you don't you know, it's the same thing with boots on the ground. Do I want to have a set of boots on the ground in 3 different cities, or do I just want to make a really good set of boots on the ground in 1 city? And the other thing is my city has a pretty large population, counting the rural areas, probably around 2 million people. So there's people dying, divorcing, having car accidents and health issues and stuff going on all the time in my town. There's more houses than I'll ever buy in this town. And don't think for a minute that this town's not competitive, because there's a guru showing up every week downtown at the auditorium to talk to people about investing. And so there is a lot of competition here, but I outsmart them and I outwork them, and I am hugely more consistent than them. Mm-hmm. Hugely more consistent. The things that I do are done every single day without fail. Whether I'm in the business or sick or on vacation, my business never stops. It's relentless.
So let's talk about that a little bit. So what does your current team look like right now in your business? And then after that, we're going to kind of reverse all the way back to how you got into it. So what's your current team look like right now?
Well, it took me 20 years to get where I am now, because most of the limitations were in my head and thinking that people couldn't do certain things because I was the only one who could do it, which was completely ridiculous. Mm-hmm. But it took a little while for me to get out of my own way. But so I have one paid person. That's my daughter, Shannon. She's in that office, and she gets paid to push deals in, close them, and then push the deals out and close them. Mm-hmm. And she's got a salary, but she gets a bonus every house in and every house out. Mm-hmm. Always in all my organization, the fundamental thing that never changes about whatever the position is the carrot's in the right place. To use a common word in your vernacular.
I love it.
The carrot's in the right place, with the exception of my daughter. But even my daughter has a carrot that's very very motivational to her to get things closed, because it's extra money for her. Everyone else gets paid on success. Everyone else is a subcontractor, and everyone else. I have 4 people that look for houses for me every day, but I have them in lanes where they're not competing with each other. If one guy liked to be on the online bidding websites, then that's his lane. No one else get on there and bid. I don't want to be bidding against ourselves. Mm-hmm. If someone's doing probate, then no one else do probate. So these guys have kind of like mounted up these lanes. And in this over lane over here, we might have delinquent property taxes and on-site webinars and these 2,000 realtors. And then this guy might have probate and these 2,000 realtors and where people have gone and appointed a substitute trustee, which is the precursor of a foreclosure. Mm-hmm. So we make sure that our 4 guys are all in different lanes, and they're not competing with each other. And then every one of them get like 2,000 realtors that they can become to befriend, because we have about 8,000 realtors in our town.
Oh, wow.
So I gave these guys 2,000 and these guys 2,000. So they're not competing with the same realtors even, you know. Mm-hmm. They're all out forging, and they're all branding cashforhouses.net. They're all branding our name to all these different people, you know. So
kind of going back to when you started, of course, you didn't immediately start with those 4 deal acquisition people. And you mentioned probate, and you've got the foreclosure stuff and like all kinds of different ways you guys are sourcing deals. How did it start, man? And then how did you bring on that first person to help you source deals?
Well, the easiest person to bring on was a salesperson, mm-hmm. you know, because there was always people that wanted to sell. But there wasn't a lot of people that understood how to sell owner-financed houses. You know, there's a lot of people that say that, oh, I sell houses. And then you try to talk to them about how you're selling your houses, and they're from the real estate world, and they don't get the owner-finance world. Yeah. So I found the right salesperson. But then I had VAs to make sure that there was consistency on the mundane things, like going to the courthouse and finding out, you know, who's on the list, this list that wasn't on that list 7 days ago, and who's on that list that wasn't on 7 days ago, and who's on this list, and then putting them into the spreadsheet, and then getting on the skip trace software and tracking these people down, where are they, and then get the mailings out. So that thing never stops, right? Mm-hmm. And then the other thing that I think you'll find important or new, or I don't know, maybe not, but I stopped trying to hire people that were interested in real estate and investing. Yeah. When I run an ad for a person to buy houses, I'm looking for a guy that was really good at selling Hoover vacuum cleaners. He was the top in his class, but he's hit a ceiling in vacuum cleaners. Yep. That I want to take him and train him how to sell houses. And the minute he starts asking me about my business, I just tell him, look, you want to go buy houses or not? Because I'm not training you. I need someone for this job. If that's not the job you want, go get a mentor and go learn how to invest. I just need someone to fill this job. Yeah. So, and I also give those people tests. I give them to make sure they're not entrepreneurial, that they are very responsible, that they are money driven, but they don't necessarily manage their money very well. Mm-hmm. That's the guy I'm looking for. And I found him. None of them had their eye on real estate, because if you go to the clubs and you get people to do this for you, they want to be you.
Yep. Yep. So it's not going to last very long, then. They're going to be moving on to the next thing and being your competitors pretty darn quickly.
Yeah. Yeah. So, and I don't explain to them my business. I don't even have them in the same room. They're not even in the same office. I just, you know, we train them on how to write a contract for a house, mm-hmm. you know, and we have a strike price. And if he gets the strike price or higher, he gets $500. If he gets it for lower than the strike price, then we split however much he saves me. A guy yesterday, I told him the strike price was $50,000 on a house. He bought it for $20,000.
And
so he saved me $30,000. He came in and says, you're probably not going to cut me that check for $15,000 though, are you? And I said, well, why wouldn't I? He said, well, that's a lot of money. And I said, well, you saved me a lot of money. You deserve the $15,000.
That's,
you know,
cool.
So I got the check. I got the house for the $20,000 plus the $15,000 for $35,000. And I told him I'd been happy at $50,000.
That's cool. That's stuff like that's, it's really cool. So how, you mentioned some tests you guys do. We do a lot of testing with our team members here at Carrot before they come aboard to make sure that they're a match for the way that they work, personality, stuff like that. I mean, literally, we find you can make or break your team, your culture, your success based on those little things. What are you guys doing on that testing side of? Are there certain particular tests you're having people go through, or is it something you made up?
No. I hire a company, and I know you're going to ask me who it is, and I don't know who it is, because,
fine.
You know, I'm like you, Trevor. We go ahead and we figure it out, and someone says, okay, we found the perfect company, and I say, okay, then do it, and I don't even know who they are.
Yep.
But I know this, that the people that they tell, that test tells me to hire, I wouldn't have picked in a million years, mm-hmm. and then they work more often than my picks.
Yep.
I say, you know, I want this guy anyways, and I pick him, he bombs out. I say, man, this guy's not going to make it. He's an engineer, for God's sake. You know, and then all of a sudden, he's been there for 2 years, and he's setting the records. You know what
That's
I mean?
That's cool. I love it. So I want to dive into the owner finance and private money side quite a bit, because I know that the listeners are going to want to talk about that. We've never talked about that stuff on the Carrot Cast, so it'll be really, really cool. So for those people who may not be familiar, what is, I guess, how is owner finance different than, let's say, lease option or lease to own or rent to own or however someone says it? How are those different?
Well, I'm just real adverse to being a landlord, except mm-hmm. for storages, which is the only thing I want to be a landlord for. I don't want to be a landlord for any family living in my property.
Yep.
I just don't like it. It's just me. There's been a lot of millionaires being landlords, but I don't like it because, first of all, I think this is my, if you want to hear the other side of the argument, that bottom line that you're supposed to make when you're a landlord, it's a myth.
Mm-hmm.
It's a myth because they're telling you all, you know, you're, you got an incoming rent of X, and you got an X going outgoing payment of Y, and so you got $350 cash flow on this property. That's, you know, $4,000 a year. No, it's not. You didn't give 1 ounce of weight to the air conditioners, the windows, the hot water heaters, the sinks, the faucets, the vandalism, the yard, the grass, the sprinkler, the garage door, the front door, the back door. Name it. It just goes on forever.
Yeah.
And they didn't. And in that statement, you know, you've got a $350 a month positive cash flow. That's the most ridiculous statement and the biggest myth I've ever seen ever perpetrated on an investor.
Mm-hmm. Dude, and I'm one of the guys that has experienced the other side of it. So we in this one property I've got, we in the past 2 years put a new roof on it. It was $16,000. We did a new paint job last year. That was about $9,000 around there. New windows 3 years ago, actually. This last week, a new hot water heater that ended up being about $800. I'm sitting there looking at it going, I actually, with that particular property, we had to actually loan that business some money to put it back into reserves because of all these big expenses we've had. Now, the good thing is hopefully we won't have those expenses for a while on that property, but like you're saying, it ate up all the cash flow for many years.
Another way you could have done it, but I don't know the price range of this house or anything, but just on the other side of the coin, I chose to be an owner financier. Yep. I buy the house for 50. I don't do anything to it. And then I owner finance it to someone, say like 100 or 110. I take 10,000 down. So I just made $10,000 right there. When was the last time you got a $10,000 non-refundable rent deposit, Trevor?
Never.
Never. How about 30? I got a $30,000 down payment yesterday. You ever get a $30,000 non-refundable rent deposit?
No, sir.
No, sir. I know one of my students got a $75,000 down payment on a $160,000 house. You ever get a $75,000 non-refundable deposit, Trevor?
No, that's cool.
And then, you know, you have between $300 and $500 positive cash flow on these properties for 25, 30 years, 20 years, 15 years, however long. And if the air conditioner breaks, it's not your air conditioner. No. You sold them the house on payments. You put the deed in their name, or you gave them, or you did a contract for deed, or whatever. You made them the owner, right? And all these things now are their responsibility. All those liabilities on the left-hand side of the page when you were a landlord just went away. Yep. And all you do is you get a payment, and if the check clears, that's your money. Now, this is quite different from being a landlord, because when you're a landlord and you get a rent payment, you're not sure if it's your money or not. Mm-hmm. Because if the air conditioner breaks, apparently it was the air conditioner man's money,
yep.
Right? You know, and what you're doing and what I was doing was a heck of a job collecting money for the roofer and the plumber and the air conditioner man. And I wasn't getting to keep any of it.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I think that when you buy a house in from your 401k or IRA and you pay cash for it and there's no underlying debt, maybe you can survive it if you don't have underlying debt.
Yeah.
But if you're trying to make the money between what you owe and what you're collecting, say the spread's $200, $300, $400, it takes one major function to wipe out your whole year.
Yep.
Not even that major sometimes. A half of an air conditioner can cost you most of your year.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so I choose to be the bank, and then all that time and all that money and all that effort that you would spend managing this property, I just choose to go find another house to buy. I take that time and I just buy another house.
Man, so this is a really interesting thing to delve into more. So, a ton of people are out there buying properties and holding, like we've been talking. They could be holding single family, multifamily, whatever, and The two differences here, I guess, are, so if you're fortunate enough to have the property, have your tenants pay for the mortgage and everything, let's say everything just breaks even, really your end game is an end game that's many, many, many years out, right? You're talking
appreciation decades. And depreciation, yeah, is what you give up when you quit being a landlord and you start being the owner financier. Mm-hmm. You give up appreciation and depreciation. But in the example that I gave you, Trevor, where I bought the house for 50 and I owner financed it for 100,000 in 30 days, exactly how much appreciation do you want?
Exactly.
And how fast? I just got it. I want my appreciation within weeks of buying the house. That was 100% appreciation. Did you notice that?
Yeah.
Okay. So the other thing I don't get is depreciation, but I have a business. You have businesses. It is a business. So there's other things to get write-offs from.
Mm-hmm. And in the end, too, once you get your income up over a certain level, and we're dealing with this right now, is you don't have the passive investment losses that you can write off up to a certain point. So if your income is over X level, which it's a decently high income that you've got to get. It's not
about
like,
a million, isn't it? It's $1 million a year.
Yeah, it's around there, but there at some point you give up the passive income.
They take it away from you. You don't give it up. They take it away.
Yeah, they take it away. They can accrue. So that's the problem, is they can accrue, and you could offset passive income. Passive, what is that? I'm not a CPA here, but you could offset
depreciation.
Exactly. Your passive losses, you can offset them with your passive gains or something like that, but you can't do it with your active income. I'm kind of butchering it a little bit, but we're going through that now.
Let's hear the other side of the story. Mm-hmm. You can be depreciating your property, but if you ever sell it, it keeps knocking your basis down. Like I had I learned the lesson, I learn things when they happen to me. Mm-hmm. So I depreciated out the storage complex for over 15 years. It had no more depreciation. It was zeroed out. Yeah. But when I sold it for $250,000, I said, but I paid $150 for it. They said, no, you depreciated that out. The whole $250 went to my bottom line as a profit.
Oh.
It was treated as profit because I had depreciated it out. So that depreciation is not free either.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I don't want to go way into it, but it forced me to go into a tax-free exchange, and I did that, and I still pushed it down the road. But it was another set of learning curves.
I talk about this kind of financial, structuring stuff forever. So on the owner finance stuff, and share whatever you're comfortable with sharing. But how many active notes do you guys have right now? And kind of the question that people are probably looking at is going, okay, so the thing that they need to look at then is now they turn into a collector, right? Which isn't a bad thing. You just have to have systems and processes for it. So how many notes do you have active, if you don't mind sharing it, and about what percentage do you guys see where people are defaulting on their payments?
Well, it goes up and down because if I find a storage I want to buy, I might liquidate 100 notes to get the cash to just walk over and drop on it, or a big down payment. Right now I have about 250 and I average about $500 a month positive cash flow. In my examples in my books, The Art of Owner Financing, My Life in 1,000 Houses, The Art of Owner Financing, I use examples that have cash flow of 350 to 400 because I'm a professional. I've been doing it for years. I don't want to strap you with a number that maybe you're not going to get to right away.
Yep.
So I move the numbers down to marginalize or minimize expectations so that people are happy and they set the right goals. Mm-hmm. But I'm averaging about 250, and like I just said, my daughter started a note collecting service. She charges $35 a month to collect the notes, and she'll do the year-end statements, and she'll send out the letters all the way up to the point of it's time to call the lawyer and get a foreclosure. But she'll even call your lawyer and tell him to start the foreclosure if you give her the permission to. But then you have to take it from there. The cool thing is, the payments that you're receiving are not rent, and the mentality that's in this house is completely different. Yeah. You might have way more leverage over a person who, let's say, bought your house 10 years ago. The house has appreciated in value, plus they put in a pool in a third room, and now this house is worth $150,000 more than what they owe you, and they're going to mess you around on a payment? I don't think so.
Yep. That's a great
you just
point.
You send your demands. You don't forgive the late fees. You tell them pay, or I'm coming after the house. Mm-hmm. Not that I'm an ogre and I don't want to come after anyone's house, but if someone's not making their payment, I have to do something.
So I want people to write that down. Is if you guys are going to do owner financing, unless you want to actually become the servicer yourself, which I don't think most people do, find a company that can do it for you. And it sounds like that's something that you guys have kind of built in-house, which is amazing. But there's all kinds of companies that do that, right?
It gets better, Trevor. Mm-hmm. It gets better because, entrepreneurs are very hard to defeat.
Yep.
Because we'll always figure a way around or over or under or through, right? We always. So when they cut my late fee in Texas from 10% down to 4%, made me mad. Like they know what I go through and the pains that I have to go through to collect these things.
Yep.
So I said, okay. And then I put my brain to it, talked to some people in my brain consortium, my table of brains. I call them my table of brains. And I called them all. And the one guy said it just like he knew I was going to call with the question. It was simple. It was easy. And now I make more money than I ever did off of late fees. You're allowed to collect principal, interest, taxes, insurance, and servicing fee. So I add $35 to every payment when I owner finance the house. I say, this is your principal, and this is going to be the interest in the payment. This is going to be your taxes. This is going to be your insurance, and this is going to be your servicing fee. And no one ever says anything.
Yep. Guys, write this stuff down. Okay, write this stuff down. So
they're paying for the servicing fee. I'm not paying for it.
Yep.
The person in the house is paying for it. And now you've got all this online where they can pay online, and it makes the bookkeeping really easy. We actually have 500 places in San Antonio, physical places that they can go make their payment, and it shows up in real time on my computer, and I know when they've paid, and it keeps the books for us. There's really good systems out there. And the easiest thing in the world to delegate, if you're looking for things to get off your plate because you want to start being a system-operated business, one of the first things you can do is collections. She'll even collect rents. She won't manage the property, but she'll tell you that the payment's in or not, and she'll send the letters if they're not in. But, you know, she's not gonna take a phone call about an air conditioner. But, you know, you can get that off your plate.
No, this is really good stuff. And guys and gals, make sure you listen to this and jotting this stuff down once again, because these are some things that are going to help you kind of cut that learning curve when you dive into owner finance. And Mitch, so here's a couple other questions on the owner finance side. So when you're going out there and marketing and picking up deals on the owner finance side versus wholesaling, are you looking for the same, the same discounts from retail on owner finance deals, or are you able to buy them for a little bit more since you're owner financing them versus wholesaling? Kind of what are you looking for your discount?
No, I'm looking for, I'm looking to buy the house at the best price I can, no matter what I'm going to do with the house. So that's just like one of the games. I mean, that's part of the game is learning how to win at negotiating, or learning how to find situations that just don't have a long fuse that have to do something right now. And you're the lucky guy who's standing right in front of them. Mm-hmm. You know, but my rule of thumb is, you know, here's the formula. And this is what I like about the owner finance strategy. The owner finance strategy is not based on comps per se. Sometimes in a hot market, the traditional comps will be higher than what the rent comps would be if you back into a sales price based on the rents. But most of the time in an average market, you take the rent, you subtract the taxes and the insurance, you multiply it by 115, and that'll give you the finance amount. That'll give you how much. So you're trying to get it. Now let's back up. The core belief of the owner finance strategy is that a guy paying $1,000 rent would rather pay $1,000 to own. Do you believe that? If you believe that, you get to make a lot of money. If you don't believe that, you can stay in the rental department.
Yeah, yeah.
So you take the $1,000, you minus, you know, $100 taxes and $50 insurance. I'm just throwing out some numbers.
Yeah.
And you come out with $850, and then you multiply that times 115, and that means that $850 will make the payment on $97,750. Let's just call it $98,000, okay? Mm. And so if that $850 will make a payment on $98,000, then what is the owner finance sales price? The owner finance sales price is add 12% on top of that. So times 12% is, you know, another $12,000 more or less. So it's $110,000 sales owner finance value. Yep. Okay. I want to make this clear. The owner finance value is not the MIA appraiser. It's not the broker's professional opinion. It's not the comps from MLS. It is that if a man paying $1,000 a month rent, this is what he can pay for this house with a $10,000 down payment or a $12,000 down payment, and he'll come out exactly the same every month, the check that he's writing. Hmm. And so that value stands on its own, and I don't care what the prices of the houses are around it, because those prices of those houses were prices based on the ability of someone to get a new loan.
Yep.
And the people that I'm selling these houses to can't get a new loan. So in the recession, Trevor, when the prices fell, when the bank stopped loaning, mm-hmm. the prices what? They fall because no one can get a loan. So the prices of the houses in the medium to low income areas really fell a lot.
Oh yeah.
So I was picking up these houses for $25,000, but the rents, what happens to rents, Trevor, when no one can buy a house?
It's increasing. More,
the rents
more demand,
go up.
Yeah.
And so in the recession, my owner finance houses are appreciating because my price is based on what the rents are.
Gotcha.
It's a very cool dynamic that it takes a little while to sink in, but it's all common sense. And that's why I love the business. This is why. I do pretty good in the good times. In the bad times, I boom like crazy because the banks shut down.
Mm-hmm.
They shut down. And so that means two things. Most people lose their ability to buy houses because it's based on the banks.
Yeah.
The bank shut down, so they lost their ability to buy the house. If you have your own cash or you have private money, that portion hasn't been shut down. That side of the business hasn't been shut down. You're still able to buy the houses. But most people's strategy is to sell it to someone who can get a new loan. Well, if the bank shut down, then the other end of your strategy is broken. Yep. So you got to have both sides working to make it work. You got to be able to buy it. You got to be able to sell it. Well, if the bank shut down, both of these things are shut down on both ends. You might be able to solve one, but see, when you owner finance, when you're using private money to buy and you're owner financing when you sell, where's the bank in this issue? There's no bank here. No. So when those banks go under, they stop. They don't stop me. I boom, because I'm like the only guy in town now that can buy a house and can sell a house. Man, or one of the few guys.
So that way of calculating that sales price was really, really cool. So guys and gals, if you didn't hear that, reverse it back, listen to it again, listen to it again, because that's a really important mindset that we've got to get over. Like you said, rather than going out and looking at the comps, you're not looking at that at all. You're looking at, hey, here's a person who is already paying X. They're already paying this.
They're subject to be a renter for the rest of their life.
Yep.
Do you think that $1,000 a month is going to stay $1,000 a month? Or you think it's probably going to go up? Yep. What would $1,000? See, this is kind of a subject dear to my heart.
No, this is good stuff. I like it.
Realtors will come up to me and go, "This house comps out at $30,000. This was during the heat of the recession.
Yeah.
This house comps out at $25,000, and you're selling it for $59,000. You're ripping these people off." I said, "No, I'm not. The person I'm selling it to is paying $850 a month rent, and he's going to be paying $850 a month till the day he dies, except for one thing. It won't be $850 when he dies." I said, "What do you think the rent's going to be in 10 years from now? Take a guess. What would $850 rent be in 10 years from now, Trevor? Take a guess."
$1,200, $1,300. I don't know, something like that.
Okay. In 15 years, what will it be?
$1,500, $1,600, $2,000?
Yeah. In 20 years, what will it be?
A lot more.
Okay. And so I look right at the realtor right in the face and I go, "I think maybe the landlords are ripping everybody off, because at the end of 20 years, my guy has no payment left."
Yep.
And the landlord's now charging him $2,000 or $2,200 a month. This poor guy has gotten behind every year of his life.
Mm-hmm.
They say, "Well, how is this guy ever going to sell this house if it comps at 25 and you're selling at 59? And this is where I say, this is really simple, lady or man, Mr. Realtor. I'll make the loan assumable if he'll just get someone to give him his down payment back, or he can get $5,000 more than what he paid me in the down payment, or he could get $10,000 more than he paid me in the down payment. Just have him get and let me review the guy, and if I like him, he can move right in and take over the note."
Yep. Yeah.
So the realtor community in general wants to bash me because I sell over the market.
Yeah.
But it's just simply not true, because these people are not going to be able to get a loan. Mm-hmm. And this is all possible because of private money. Let's talk about that, because that's really key.
No, so let's definitely transition into that. So one question I've got on the private money side on how you structure it is, so if you're doing notes, and the notes you're doing, they're long-term notes, it sounds like. They're regular 20, 30-year notes to the buyers, the home buyer.
Yeah, they're usually 30 years.
Okay. So what do you do? How are you structuring that on the private money side then with the lender? Are they also lending for 30 years? Or do you have
okay, well, let me tell you.
How are you doing that?
Let's back up to some basics first, then we'll go right into that. Because the basic is this. You can make a great living in almost every strategy of real estate, all these niches, all these creative real estate investing niches, but all of them have to be funded somehow or another, right?
Yep. Yep.
Typically, even subject twos, people, "Well, you don't have to in subject two." That's not true. You got to make up back payments. You got to fix things up. You know, there could be an easy $15,000 in a subject two deal that you got to come up with, right? Mm-hmm. Easy. So you can make a good living in these niches, but the difference between making a good living and being a multi-millionaire on and on is private money, because there's nothing I can't buy. I mean, last month we brought in 18 houses. Office called me a little bit worried. "Hey, we need $978,000 to close these 18 deals in the next 15 days. And just to make a point to let them know, still who's daddy, okay?" I picked up the phone right in front of them and got it done in 3 phone calls.
Huh. Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
We're closing in 15 days. They'll all be closed within 15, 20 days.
Yeah.
So I borrow money at 8% interest only. It's between 6 and 8. Depends on risk. Sometimes I get down to no-brainer loans. Like, I need $30,000 on a house that's worth $150,000. 6% is pretty good when you got a first lien position on a house that's worth $1 billion more than what they're loaning, you know? Yep. So, typically it's around 8%. I average borrowing 52% of the owner financed value. Remember that number now? Okay. That's the owner financed value, not the value. It's the owner financed value based on the rents, that formula where we backed in. Yep. I average borrowing 52% of that number. So on a, if the owner finance value is $100,000, then I'm averaging borrowing $52,000. I'm giving someone a first lien on my property through a title company, pristine insured first lien on that house for $52,000 that the rents prove and dictate, and that my whole life of 20 years says that I can sell for $100,000 if not $110,000.
Yep.
Okay? So it's a pretty irresistible offer to most of the people these days, because almost all of my private lenders – are up in years, in their late 60s, if not their mid 70s or early 80s. Mm-hmm. They're scared to death of the stock market now, because they used to be worth $1 million and now they're worth $500,000.
Yeah.
And they're not going back, because they lost that other half in that stock market and they got so scared that they had to pull the chain, and they're never going back again. Yeah. So now they got their money sitting around in this 1% CD or less, and they can't live off of it. You know, I hope as our new administration moves in, I won't be upset if interest rates go up a little bit, because we have this big volume of people called the baby boomers who are all retiring now at the tune of about 10,000 a day, and they can't live off of 1% on their money. Mm-hmm. It doesn't even keep up with the increasing price of a loaf of bread.
Yeah.
You know? So anyways, that's what I'm finding them. These is what I'm offering. I want 8% interest only for 5 years, non-recourse, which means collateral only loan. I mean, you either get paid or you get my house. Okay. That's the two choices.
Yep.
And I also look them square in the eye and say, I have those two choices and I can exercise those two choices anytime I want to. And if you don't like those two choices, either one of them, then don't take the deal. Mm-hmm. You don't need to look at me, my credit. You don't need to look at, you can if you want to, I'm happy to show it to you, but it has nothing to do with me. You're either going to get me or you're going to get that house over there. So I would focus on, what do you think that house is worth? And is that a good piece of collateral?
Mm-hmm.
So that's how I put it. So if I ever have to give a house back, which I never have in my career, but if I ever do, it was part of my two choices. I only had two choices. I made the payment and paid you back, or I gave you the house.
Yeah.
Now, what would not be right is if I collected money from this house and I didn't pay them and I made them fight for that deed.
Oh,
if I can't pay them, I'll go hand it to them. They won't have to go to court or foreclose on me or anything. But that's just me.
And you know, I mean, your business wouldn't last very long operating that way anyway. It'd last one cycle, then you'd be done if you're operating that way.
Okay,
anyway,
but I talk about the worst case scenario.
Yep.
But then I say, what's going to happen in this world that a 3-bedroom, 2-bath, 1,200 square foot, middle of the road house isn't worth anything? Mm-hmm. Because if that house becomes worth nothing, your money lost its value a long time ago.
Oh yeah.
No matter where you had it,
Yeah.
You know, so I'd still rather have the sticks, because the currency could do whatever it wants to. It could be manipulated. It could go down. But those 2x4s are still going to be worth some money.
Yep.
And not only the 2x4s going to be worth money, but they're already erected in the shape of a house.
Mm-hmm. And there's always going to be a demand for housing. So
yeah.
So on the structure, I just kind of want to unpack the structure of it a little bit. So you mentioned it's a 5-year interest only note. So at that 5 years, are they then? You give them the option to roll it again into another 5-year term. Do you pay them off? Do you put another private lender in place for that deal?
Okay, I wrote like 4 pages on this, and I got it exactly right. And I'm not going to be able to cram all this in here, but yeah, you'll get the gist of it. It's at my blog, 1000houses.com, Mitch Stephen, and look at the blog piece that says why I borrow at the terms I do.
Okay.
1000houses, 1000houses.com / Mitch Stephen. My last name is Stephen. Anyways, or just go to 1000houses.com and find my blog. But look at the piece, why I borrow at the terms I do. But let's just say that it went 5 years and I couldn't pay them back, and I couldn't get a new loan, or I couldn't find another private lender to take their place, and they didn't want to extend. Their choice is to take the house.
Mm-hmm.
So let's just say if I bought a house for $98,000 and I sold it for $110,000 with $12,000 down. This is the same example we've been using.
Yeah,
I borrowed $50,000 to get that done, or about 50. Let's just say 50 for easy math. And I borrowed 50 and I sold it at 110 and I took 12,000 down and I had a $98,000 note. And I collected the 12,000 I put in my pocket. So I made 12,000 on that day when I sold it with owner financing on the down payment. And then I collected 500, and I'm just picking a number here, yeah, but it's going to be close. I'm collecting around $500 a month for 5 years. That's 60 months. 500 times 60 equals, that's $30,000. So between the down payment and the 60 months worth of positive cash flow, I've collected $42,000. How much money do I have out of my pocket, Trevor?
Eight. None. Oh, yeah, none. I'm sorry. Yeah.
None. I borrowed it all.
Yep.
Okay. So I made $42,000 with none of my own money. And if it only lasts for 5 years and I have to give them the house back, is that a bad deal?
Never.
Never. No, it's not. It's not a bad deal. If I could do that about 10 times a month, I'd be extremely wealthy.
Yep.
But banks, just like tenants, have a different mindset than owners, owner occupants. Mm-hmm. Private lenders have a much different mindset than bank lenders. Private lenders don't want their money back.
Yeah.
They're living off that interest. When you pay them off, now they got to start spending their principal for next month's bills. And they in the old timers are really, really adverse to touching their principal. Mm-hmm. It's one of the reasons why I send interest only. This is like one of the things I talked about. Mm-hmm. They're up in years. They're not really capable of, I mean, I'm sure they are, but they're just not going to go and look at an amortization schedule and figure out how much of the check they just got they can spend in interest and how much they have to put back in the bank. So I just say this is easy. When you get a check, it's all interest. You can spend it all. Until you get that really big one, that's your principal.
Yeah.
And so that's the reason why I do interest only. So they know what they can spend.
And it's nice on the on the lender side. We do a good bit of private lending myself, and it is really nice getting that darn check each month. You know, rather than having to wait that year or 3 years or 5 years to get the balloon with the payment with the interest in there, it's pretty sweet getting your interest payment every single month. And I can just totally see that, especially if you are counting as that as part of that as your living income. So that's really really it's like an annuity that keeps paying off.
I would rather have an amortized loan, but most older people do not want to give you a 15 or a 20 year loan because in their mind, they're not going to live to see it.
Yep.
It's through. But they'll always extend, but that's not the point. At some point you have to start amortizing because you've got a 30 year amortizing loan and I mean, you've given someone else a 30-year amortizing loan on the house because you owner financed it to them for that much, and you've got a non-amortizing loan. Of course, it would take years and years and years to break even because they got a 30-year note at $98,000, and I got an interest only on 50. How many years does it take to pay down on a 30-year note, $98,000 down to 50? Like 15 years, maybe longer?
Yeah.
So technically, we got a long time before we're upside down. But what happens is – but I never really have the loans for 5 years because in 3 or 4 years from now, the people are paying good. The house is going up in value. They've generally improved the house themselves. So the spread between, you know, this house now is probably worth 150 now, you know, over the 4 or 5 year period. Somewhere along the way, I can take that note that they owe me. And I'm doing this right now, Trevor. I have 20 notes. I have 20 notes. I average about $50,000. Of borrowed money per every house, but I sold those notes for on an average $100,000 for every house. So I double, so I owe $1 million, but I'm owed $2 million, and I'm taking that $2 million worth of notes and I'm pledging it at a community bank, and they're giving me a 4.5% loan, fully amortized, 15-year, prime plus one, adjustable every 5 years, with a 9% ceiling cap, with no covenants. Gotcha. Covenants meaning, they can't, as long as I'm making my payment, they can't call the payment. There's no ratios. There's no excuses for them to say, well, we're going to call the note. They can't call my note. They cannot not renew my note. The only thing they can do is just adjust it prime plus one every 5 years, which is just two adjustments in a 15-year mortgage, five and year 10.
Yep.
And then I set a ceiling, but it can never go over 9%. Well, I'm paying about 9% now.
Mm-hmm.
So every month that goes by that I'm at 4.5%. And so then I borrow just $1 million of my underlying debt. I pledge the $2 million in notes, and that's how I get out of most of them. And when I do that, the difference between 8% and 4.5% on $1 million bundle of notes is about I increase my cash flow $60,000 a year.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Now most of that 60 is acknowledged in principal reduction. So I don't really get it in my hand, but it goes up on my tax statement because I'm paying down principal now. Instead of having an interest only loan, I got principal reduction. But anyways, so, and there's other ways, and I don't want to go way into it, but there's, you could sell the notes. And I know how to sell notes with no discounts. I've been selling notes with no discounts all my life. And that's another interesting phenomenon, but that I could talk to you about 2 hours on that, you know? but I know how to sell notes with no discount.
Man, so this like I said, this stuff's fascinating. I love it when you can put numbers on a piece of paper and really get smart and really do the numbers and have the numbers do the heavy lifting for you. I think a lot of people they'll go, and especially if they're just getting started, they'll go and do some research on bigger pockets or whatever it is, and they go with the traditional conventional wisdom of these, you know, these formulas for wholesaling as an example, that it's here's what everyone in bigger pockets is doing. That's awesome. But when you actually sit down and see, okay, how can I get a little bit more sophisticated with this? How can I get a little smarter with this rather than having to go out there and do everything the way everyone else is doing? Your results can be way, way, way different. And it's so cool to see the different ways you've tackled these deals. One question that popped up, man, so there's the Dodd-Frank stuff, you know, that came out several years back. How are you guys, I guess, is there anything you guys are having to deal with because of that?
And oh, absolutely.
What are you guys doing?
Well, absolutely. In my state, and see, this is, I was on Bigger Pockets talking about what I'm doing, mm-hmm. and all the people from California told me that I was, you know, committing a crime and that I was going to go to prison and everything. I said, you know, maybe in California, I don't know what your laws are, but in Texas, I'm fine. And in Georgia, we're fine. And in Missouri and Alabama and a whole bunch of places, we're fine. Mm-hmm. I finally had to get off of Bigger Pockets because they're like telling me I'm a criminal. I'm like, you know, I'm not. Yeah. The one thing they were citing was Dodd-Frank. Well, in Texas, we're allowed to hire a RMLO, a residential mortgage loan originator, to stand between me, the seller, and my buyer for a certain amount of time through a certain amount of disclosures and in a certain way the paperwork has to go. And actually, those guys have passed the test to keep me compliant. So I hire them and pay them a fee per deal to keep me compliant. And end of story. I didn't read the 2,300 pages. I don't care what the 2,300 pages says. This guy's licensed to keep me compliant. I hired him. And if we're not compliant, then sue him. Mm-hmm. You know, I just do what he says and I pay him a fee per house.
Yep.
Now, it's really tragic because I used to be able to meet some people at 8 o'clock in the morning, and by 5 o'clock at night, they'd give me the down payment. We'd sign the papers and they'd be moving in on the same day that I met them. Wow. Now it takes 30 days and some of them don't qualify anymore. I was the one who decided if they qualified or not.
Yep.
Now Dodd-Frank does. There's some things. Anyways, but what's really tragic is all these laws are passed in the name of consumer protection, right? The air quotes. And all it did was it caught – they can't get in a house quickly now. And I'm passing – I used to not have closing costs. Now I do. Mm-hmm. And all those fees that it cost me, that legislation cost me, it all goes on to my buyer.
Yep.
You know?
Yep.
So – and if he can't afford the closing costs, those extra fees, then I just add it on top of the note.
Mm-hmm.
So you'll love this, Trevor. I call it my buyer's retirement matching plan. It's my 401k, okay? It cost me $850 to hire the RMLO. But if I bought carpet for $850 for my house, Trevor, would I just charge an extra $850 or would I charge $1,700?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, more.
Okay. So if I'm going to have to do all this stuff and pay my own money, I've got to charge a premium. I got to make money on everything that costs me money. I got to mark it up a little bit. Got to mark it up just – so if they don't have the money for the closing costs, then I put in my $850. Let's say that their loan was going to be $50,000. I put in their $850, but they owe me $1,700 at 10.5% for 20 years. It's my buyer's matching retirement plan. I put in $850, they matched me $850, they owe me $1,700. That's how I look at it.
Mm-hmm. And like you said, I mean, you're getting a buyer into a house at a payment that they're already comfortable paying, and now they own a house, which is
that won't go up anymore. Cool. The rent was certainly going to go up.
Yep, exactly, right? Exactly. Man, this, like I said, the whole owner finance thing is fascinating. And so is the private lending thing, the private lending side of it. I mean, we're definitely in a different environment today than we were, let's say, in 2008, 9, 10 on the bank side of it. What are you seeing right now? And what are you kind of, I'm not going to hold you to it, but what's your crystal ball say over the next year, 2 or 3 years, as far as how the bank stuff is going. Because some markets are heating up as far as being seller markets. Banks are kind of opening up a little bit again. But what are you seeing on that side of it?
Well, two things. One is I see that Dodd-Frank will probably go away in the first 100 days of the new administration. Mm-hmm. It might not all go away, but I bet you little people like you and me won't even qualify to have to do it.
Yep.
It was about to go away anyways. Because they were gonna let the small guys off, like under 100 houses, which the real estate lobbyists reduced down to 25 houses a year. But that's still good enough. That's okay. Mm-hmm. The banks, I wouldn't be surprised if interest rates went up a little bit. I don't think it's going to be horrible. Mm-hmm. But like I said, a little bump in the interest rate would be good for our country right now because we have so many senior citizens that are trying to retire and they can't live off of 1%.
Yeah.
I mean, neither can – no one can. It's ridiculous. It's stupid. It's not even really 1%. Most of it's under 1%. So – but as long as the playing field's level, like, you know, if the interest rates go up 2 or 3%, it'll be across the board. It'll be for you. It'll be for me. It'll be for everybody. You know, we're still going to make money, there's no one going to have an unfair advantage. Mm-hmm. So, and, you know, I used to pay my private lenders 10%, but rates got so low and I was competing against people that were borrowing money from the bank that I had to tell my private lenders, I've got to reduce the rate to 8% because I can't get the money out because I can't compete because I'm competing against bank money, which is way lower than you. Mm-hmm. I don't want bank money. I could go get bank money, and I do at a certain point. But I really don't want bank money in the beginning because I like the non-recourse, and I like the speed of the private money, And more often than not, and I like the non-recourse and the speed. And eventually all these people become my friends too. So I have all these fantastic private lender friends that are the most mixed batch of people you've ever seen in your life.
I bet. And that's a cool thing too. I mean, like you said, there's a whole other side of the business where you truly are providing a really great service to your private lenders where they can either go out there. I know I'm the kind of guy who I don't like putting my money in the stock market. I don't understand it. I can't look at it on a daily basis and make moves that are, you know, based on me actually knowing what I'm talking about. And so every time, you know, there's any dollars that go into a darn a stock, I'm like, I don't like it. So there's a lot of people out there like that, you mentioned, that they got burnt by it maybe many times over the years. And you're able to cut them checks every single month and
well, let me tell you this. I've been paying a lot of these people over 20 years or right at 20 years. No, over 20 years. And they used to give me like half of what they owned because they, in the name of diversity, they're going to take half their money, their wealth, and they're going to put it in other buckets. Yep. Well, on at least 10 occasions, people have called me and said, hey, how are we doing the house business? I mean, I kind of noticed this concern. It usually happens right after they watch American Greed on TV.
Oh, yeah.
They'll call me up and go, is this a Madoff scheme? Or, you know, and I'll go, well, if everyone in Bernie Madoff's organization would have had a first lien on a real piece of property, mm-hmm. none of them would be broke. Not yep. one of them. Not one of them. And I say, this is how you know. You go down and get your papers and look at that time, date, stamped, notarized by the county clerk document that's filed at the courthouse, and you can get on the computer and see your name down there at the courthouse on this address. That tells you that this that you're not in the scam department. Mm-hmm. You're either going to get paid or you're going to get a house. This was way different than the scams. Yep. The scammer guys said they gave you the documents, and they did give you a set of papers, but they were never filed. Yeah. And then they went and borrowed the money on the same house over and over and over these different towns. Anyways, they call me, and I'll tell them, no, I said, why are you concerned? And they'll go, well, you have everything we own now. I said, well, I thought you gave half. He said, well, we don't have that half anymore. And inevitably, they either lost it in the stock market during the tech crash or they loaned it to Uncle Bernie for a snow cone factory in Alaska, and it didn't work out for some reason.
Man, I could keep talking about these topics for a long time. So, dude, where can people – like literally, we can go off into rabbit holes and all kinds of topics, and I love it. So where could people go to learn more of about what you do? I know you mentioned 1000houses.com. I'm on there. I've got the website pulled up here, and you've got a bunch of articles up there. Is that kind of the spot that they should go to dive in more deeply here?
You could go to 1000houses.com/books where you could see the three books I wrote. They're all under the heading of My Life in 1000 Houses, kind of like the – I don't know the brand, but there's a Failing Forward to Financial Freedom, which is a more or less an autobiographical account of how a dummy me figured out how to finally make some money and rinse and repeat and rinse and repeat till I did it a huge amount of times. And then there's then because of that book, everyone kept saying, how in the heck do you find so many deals so consistently? So I wrote the book, My Life in 1,000 Houses, 200 plus ways to find bargain properties, which of course is much drier than the first book. The first book's a story, and it's a bunch of stories. Some, a lot of them where I fall down. This is a how-to, little drier, but I try to make it fun. Mm-hmm. And then the last one was the one that I really wanted to write all along was My Life in 1,000 Houses, The Art of Owner Financing, where I give all the case examples of the different ways I structure deals with the underlying money, with the incoming money, with the different expenses. I write about deals I got in trouble on and the reasons why and how I things I do and don't do anymore so those don't happen to me again. Mm-hmm. And a lot of real case scenarios. And unlike a lot of people, I like to show the very ugly parts of the business too, because I think it's unfair to just show someone the pretty parts of the business. So I'll show you deals that I got kicked in the head on, you know, like, dang, you know, that hurt, you know, so that you won't make that mistake. So you go to 1000houses.com/deal and you could check out the owner finance online course I have, or you can go to 1000houses.com/start and that'll get you my $7 book offer and you can get my books there. But mostly just kick around that site. There's so much free stuff there. And there's also my blog. You talked about I do a good thing for the investors. There's so many wins in the owner finance department that I wrote a page called Win-Win Situation. And there's about 15 different wins. Everybody wins. Mm-hmm. Everyone's winning. And I went to describe how many winners there really are when I buy a crack house on the lower part of town and I start to fix it up. I mean, the municipalities win, the neighborhood wins, the lender wins, the person who's moving in the house and getting out of a rent house, they win. It just goes on and on and on. You wouldn't believe how much you affect a community.
Man, this is good stuff. I'm on Amazon right now, browsing through the books and stuff. And guys and gals, head over there. Seriously, I mean, we're talking. This isn't going to be a $1,000 purchase to get one of these books here. I mean, these books are. They're books, right? But they have all of his amazing experiences in there. So that's the first thing I would do, guys and gals, is head to his blog. If you like the topics of owner financing, if you want to find out how Mitch is finding these properties, head over there and then also head over to Amazon. And just look it up, My Life in 1,000 Houses. Put in his name and then you'll find his books in there. Mitch, man, so amazing having you on this call. And I'm so glad you could take the time out to hop on the Carrot Cast with us. And I know we probably barely scratched the surface with the wisdom you can pass along to our members, but I really appreciate it. Do you have any parting words for people? Let's say it's a person who's done some deals and they've heard the owner finance side of it. And, they're going, man, you know, is this something I should dive into? What advice do you have for someone?
Well, if you're thinking about owner financing, we really need to discern two things. One is, are you in a state where that state's okay with you being the bank, or how much stress are they going to put on you for that? The other thing is how difficult is it in your state to foreclose on a house? Like in Oregon, man, it's really hard to get people out of a house.
Yeah, it is.
You know, so but that doesn't mean that we couldn't find a certain paper trail or a certain way to do things that would work for us. Mm-hmm. But that would be the first things in the owner finances. You know, give me a call, or I'm not too hard to find. You can find me. You can find my phone number easy. Mm-hmm. If you can't find my phone number, then stay out of the house business, because you're going to have to find a lot harder people to find than me.
That's right.
Call me and we'll talk about, you know, if your situation's right, and then you could go from there. The biggest thing is try to find the niche that's right for you. Mm-hmm. Owner finance may not be right for you. You might be better. You might want to do products like Trevor, or you might want to be a landlord, whatever it is. But find out where your passion is. Get all the free stuff you can on the internet about it. Make sure that's kind of what you want to do. Maybe even, but then get a mentor. At the end of the day, find and get a mentor, because you're going to pay for the education one way or the other. Mm-hmm. And it's much more expensive to do it through mistakes than it is to pay a mentor. I'll promise you. I live the other way.
I'm with you.
I would have saved so much money. I would have saved, and you know what? It almost cost me my career that's been worth millions to me millions and millions to me, because I almost quit because I made some mistakes that almost that made me look bad, made me feel bad, didn't make me look too good in front of my wife. And I almost quit that business because I didn't have someone telling me where the cliffs were. You know, I was just running right off of them. Preaching to the choir, right?
No, dude, this is funny. I was talking with an entrepreneur and a big investor yesterday. He's back east. He owns tens of millions of dollars in real estate, and he has a great business. But at the same time, he's going through some things right now that he needs advice from someone even ahead of him. And he's like, "Man, I'm going through these things." He doesn't have a mentor at that level. And we were just talking about it. He's like, "So that's what even that guy's seeking it out." So whether you're brand new, whether you're at this level and you're looking to get to the next, find that person who's been there before you. Ideally, you know, possibly who's been there in the past 3 to 5 years, so it's fresh in their mind, but also someone who's been doing, you know, who has been through that exact phase you're wanting to go through and has been through it at any time in their lives is amazing. And align with that person, guys and gals, because the whole game of life is not an individual game, that's for sure.
So can I chime in? Because
yes.
I still, after hundreds and hundreds, over thousands of deals, I'm still at 15 years in the game. I was making great money, but I hadn't mastered the time side of it. Mm-hmm. I was working my butt in the ground, and I was getting tired. And I paid $25,000 to go to a mastermind that had people in my industry, a lot of them more successful than me, no doubt about it. And I paid that money because I saw who was in that room, and I paid to go there once a quarter for a year, for 4 meetings, and they changed my life. Mm. And now they taught me about systems. I went there to figure out about systems. I'd failed at systems the whole 15 years. I'd put them in, they'd collapse. I put them in, they weren't right. It was a disaster. And I had given up on me owning a business. I was always going to be the guy working in the business. I'd given up.
Yep.
Then I got a breath again, said, I got to try again. So I went back to but this time I went to pros, mm-hmm. and I let them counsel me. It cost me $25,000 for that year. It's the best money I ever spent. And let me tell you what it resulted in. In 2015, I bought just under 100 houses. I didn't see any of them. I didn't see anyone who bought them.
Yeah.
I might have sold 10 of the houses because I got bored and I just wanted to ride around with my guys. But I didn't have to see them. I probably saw 10. I didn't see any of my buyers. I didn't see one of them. I don't know their names. Other than a spreadsheet, I don't know their names. And I got now I have my financial freedom, but I also have my time freedom now. Mm-hmm. And that's why I said, you know, I just bought a ranch and I'm out. I call myself flipping a ranch. I may never sell it. I don't know. I've fallen in love with it. So we're all growing. We all have another level to go to, no matter who we are. And don't underestimate the power of people that have been there before you and are doing more than you. If they're willing to talk to you, they are a precious jewel.
I love it, Mitch. That's probably an amazing spot to stop this episode of the CareCast. Guys and gals, go check out Mitch's site, 1000houses.com, and browse around in there. And like I said, connect with Mitch. Just connect with him if you guys are wanting to dive into something that he's been there, done that, can help you. And Mitch, once again, man, thanks for hopping on this call. And I look forward to the next time that we're able to chat, whenever that is. And maybe it's another CareCast. And thanks for being the person you are, man. Being that inspiration for someone, going out there and sharing the knowledge you have, so other people can kind of cut the learning curve and not make the same mistakes, man. So I really appreciate your time. Thank you.
Man, I appreciate you and I love your product. Thank you.
Thanks, dude. I appreciate it. Thanks, guys and gals. Have an amazing rest of the week. And go and listen to our other episodes of the CarrotCast at CarrotCast.com. And you can listen to other amazing stories in addition to Mitch's. Thanks, guys and gals. Have an amazing week.